is in the world. And we always start out with these nice words, to get us in the song. You guys ready? Here's a note. Here's a note. There's a note. One, two, three.
Ooh.
Ooh. Ooh. We'll do it again.
Ooh. Ooh. Bring your tithe and bring your shame. Bring your guilt and bring your pain. Don't you know that's not your name? You will always be much more to me. Every day I wrestle with the voices that keep telling me I'm not right. But that's all right, 'cause I hear a voice and he calls me. Bring your doubts and bring your tears. Bring your hurts and bring your tears. There'll be no condemnation here.
Oh, you are holy, righteous, and redeemed.
Every time I fall, there'll be those who will call me a mistake. Well, that's okay, 'cause I hear a voice and he calls me.
Me love him more
than he who
life, and that's the hardest thing to do, to trust in Him. In the Lord, to stand in His love.
When darkness tries to roll over my bones, when sorrow comes to steal the joy I own, when brokenness and pain is all I know, I won't be shaken. I won't be shaken. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. Shame no longer has a place to hide. I am not a captive to my lies. I'm not afraid to leave my past behind. I won't be shaken. I won't be shaken. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. fear doesn't stand a chance when I'm staring in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I'm staring in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I'm staring in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I'm staring in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I'm staring in your love. There's power that can break off every chain. There's power that can empty out a grave. There's resurrection power that can save. There's power in your name. Power in your name. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand. Stand a chance when I'm staring in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I'm staring in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I'm staring in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I'm staring in your love. Doesn't stand a chance when I'm standing in your love. Oh, and I'm standing in your love. Oh, and I'm standing on my. I'm standing, yes, I'm standing in your love.
Embrace. You are the hope with us. I know we have quite a few people that are traveling right now, and we had the young people that took off this morning for camp. They're on their way to move, this week in Illinois, and I think they had 20 or so young people go, and then all the workers. They had a couple of vanfuls here that pulled out about 8:15 or so this morning, so we'll be keep them in your prayers this week, our young people, that God would move in their hearts and in their lives as they're away. How many of you have kids that went this morning and you're excited about it? Yes, I saw more hands go up then. Amen. That's great. Well, let's have a word of prayer to start our time this morning, and then we'll jump into God's word. Lord, we love you. We thank you for your word that we can open. We thank you for a place that we can come and we can open your word and we can hear from you. Lord, I pray that you would be with our young people as they're gone to move right now, that you would, even now as they're driving, that you would keep them safe. Lord, we pray that you would protect the drivers, that they would stay awake, that there wouldn't be any, and protect everyone else on the road, Lord, that there wouldn't be any accidents or anything like that. We pray for our young people as they're there, that you would keep them safe. We pray that you would work in their hearts. Most importantly, Lord, that they would make decisions for you this week as they're away from us. Pray for Rosemary Maxey, Lord, with her physical needs that she's going through right now. Pray that you would give doctors wisdom as they can figure out what's going on, and that you would just touch her body. Pray that you'd continue to be with Nancy Langley as she's in rehab right now from surgery. We pray that you would give her strength with her leg, that she would be able to get through that quickly. Also pray for the Garcia family, Lord, and the loss of Deb's dad, that you would give comfort there and bless them in this as they go through this difficult time, as only you can give comfort. We also pray for Diane Terry's mom as she's having these physical needs, that you would be with her today, that you would give her a good day, and you'd be with Wayne and Diane and give them wisdom. Lord, we pray for this service. We pray as we open your word that you would speak to our hearts. We love you. We ask it in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Well, we are in the book of Jonah, going through and discussing the life of this reluctant prophet. It's a short book, only four chapters, but there is a whole lot of information in these four short little chapters. This reluctant prophet Jonah, we saw God called him to go and preach to those who are in this city of Nineveh, which was the capital Syria of Assyria. And again, these Assyrians were a brutal people. We saw how history tells us that they would come in and they would conquer a city, and the horrific things that they would do to the people of these cities. We saw how they would torture and kill, and how they would even behead and build pyramids of the heads outside of a city just to alert everybody else who came by, don't mess with us, we're the baddest of the bad. We saw these people were not good people. We also know that through Jewish history that Jonah's father, Amittai, was killed by these people. So Jonah was sent by God to preach to people who had killed his own father and many of his Jewish countrymen. So this wasn't just a prophet who heard from God and was told to go preach to some people and really didn't feel like going to that town, so he went to another area. Jonah had some strong feelings towards these people that God had told him to go preach to. So that gives us a little background to know why Jonah, instead of going 550 miles just up to Nineveh across the land there, he went down into Joppa, got on a boat, and started heading out to a city called Tarshish, which is a long way away, 2,500 miles. We know the story of while he's in the boat, he goes down into the hold and falls asleep, and God brings a great storm onto the sea. And the sailors on the ship became very afraid, and they began to call out to their gods and throw out the things that they had, all their cargo out into the sea to lighten the load so they'd be able to stay afloat. And finally the captain comes down and wakes Jonah up and asks him how he could be sleeping at a time like this, and call on your God. And they bring Jonah up and begin to cast lots, or like in our days be throwing dice to see, you know, who got the short straw, whose fault this was. And when they finally realize that Jonah was the problem, he owns up to it and says that he's running from God. And to figure out how they could calm this storm and appease God, Jonah tells them, throw me over into the ocean. Man, that's pretty serious. But after a little while, even after the sailors said that they didn't want to do that and began, the Bible says, to row even harder, realized that fighting against God just never works. You ever tried to fight against God? Let me just clue you in. You don't win. So Jonah eventually gets tossed over into the sea, and as he's going down, he feels like chapter 2 that we looked at last week felt like he was going down into hell. Felt like he was going to die. But God had prepared a fish to come and swallow Jonah. And we saw Jonah turn back to God in the stomach of this great fish last week. We saw how he turned to God, and God heard his cry and brought him up out of the fish after 3 days and three nights, signifying how Jesus would be in the earth, the belly of the earth, 3 days and three nights after his crucifixion, before he rose again. So this great fish spits Jonah out, and we don't know where it was, but again, we talked about there's no way it could have been in front of Nineveh. But so the very closest point from Nineveh would be about 200 miles that Jonah would have to travel to finally obey what God had told him to do. So Jonah decides he is going to obey God, takes this journey to head towards the city that he's supposed to go to after just riding in this great fish. You know, I always wondered if the fish was more relieved to get rid of Jonah or if Jonah was more relieved to get out of the fish. I don't know the answer to that question, but I'm sure both of them were relieved in more ways than one. So last week we see Jonah's prayer and how he turned to God, how God delivered him, and God gave him the opportunity of a second chance, which is where we pick up our story today in chapter number 3, where we look at Jonah's second chance. So in your Bible, in God's Word, let's look at Jonah chapter 3. Let's start looking in verse number 1. Now the word of the Lord came to Jonah the second time, saying. I think this is awesome, and it's something that we could skim over very easily if we're not careful. But the first few words there says that the word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time. God came back and talked to Jonah again, even though he didn't obey and listen the first time. And even when we run from God, and even when we turn our back on God, isn't it awesome that he doesn't give up on us? He's always promised to be there. And he came back to Jonah again. Verse 2, "Arise," God says to Jonah, "go to Nineveh, that great city, and preach to it the message that I tell you." So Jonah, I'm going to tell you again what I want you to do. Go preach to the people that you hate more than anything else in this world. And Jonah, you're going to tell them exactly what I tell you to tell them. Now, Nineveh, the people he hates. Nineveh is an interesting city because does anybody know where Nineveh is today, what it is the modern day city of? It's close. It is Mosul, which is in northern Iraq. So Jonah was sent to a place that even today people have very strong feelings towards to preach repentance. And what's amazing is as we go through here, we're going to see that a great revival happened in northern Iraq. How cool would it be to see a great revival in northern Iraq today? A place where Christianity is persecuted, where Christians are not, you're not allowed to believe what we believe. But God turned a city upside down. So let's continue in our story. Jonah takes off. He's got this 200-mile minimum journey that would have, historically they say, would have taken him over a month to travel. So verse 3. So Jonah arose and went to Nineveh according to the word of the Lord. Now Nineveh was an exceedingly great city, a 3 days' journey in extent. So Jonah gets up and heads to Nineveh. And this city, the Bible says here, is an exceedingly great city. From different archaeological digs, they have found, and historically we see that Nineveh was a city that was 60 miles long and had inside its city walls, just the citizens, were over 120,000 people. This wasn't just a small town, and it wasn't just some little tribe off to the side or what we can picture in our mind a lot of times about cities in this day of being just small little things. This was a huge city. This city was founded by... anybody know? He's the great-grandson of Noah, and his name was Nimrod. Anybody heard of Nimrod? He's known in Genesis as the great hunter. So Nimrod was the founder of this city. And in fact, they found one wall of the city that had a circumference of 8 miles and had over 1,500 towers on it. This was a serious city that Jonah was sent to. I mean, this is an impressive enemy. And can you imagine Jonah, a person who had been persecuted by this city, a man who hated these people and they hated him, was walking up to this city, seeing the size of this place, seeing these towers on this wall. Can you imagine how scared and intimidated he must have been? But God's will never lead us where God's grace can't keep us and God's power cannot use us. God kept Jonah safe. God gave him the power to do what he was supposed to do. Jonah was as safe there in the middle of that city as any one of us have ever been in any part of our life, because when we are in the center of God's will, it is the safest place for us to be. I have a sister, and her husband served as missionaries in South Africa for a while. And the area that they were in had huge snakes, so I was out. I never even went to visit. They found a cobra skin in their front yard, and then they even found one in the crib of my nephew. When they started telling me this stuff, I was like, God bless you. I'll see you when you come back. I'm out. I don't do snakes. But one of the things that my sister and brother-in-law kept saying is, you know, we are safer here than we could be in any part of the United States because we are in the center of God's will. And as a Christian, when we are in the center of God's will, it doesn't matter what storm or what trial or what problem we are facing, we are as safe as anyone in the world because we are in God's hand. We are safe with our God. And Jonah was just as safe as he could be in this place. Look at verse 4. And Jonah began to enter the city on the first day's walk. Then he cried out and said, "Yet 40 days and Nineveh shall be overthrown." So Jonah travels a day's walk into here, which would have been about 20 miles into the city, and starts preaching a message. And when we look at the message that we read here, it's 8 words. Some of you wish I'd do that this morning, wouldn't you? 8 words, we're out. In Hebrew, it's only 5 words. But his message that we have here is 40 days and Nineveh will be overthrown. You know, 40 is an interesting number in Scripture. It's usually identified with testing and judgment. So this man walks into this city and says, in 40 days, y'all are going down. You're going to be overthrown. Now, wait a minute. These are the baddest of the bad warriors in the world. Nobody's beat these guys. And some crazy-looking homeless guy walks through the city and says, somebody's coming to beat us. Can you imagine what they were thinking about Jonah? They got to be thinking, I mean, come on, has he seen what we can do? Has he not heard of our tales that have been told of how we treat people when we go in and conquer them? I mean, hasn't he seen what we do to these kind of people? But Jonah's message to these people would have been difficult to swallow, pun intended. Remember the fish? That was a bad joke, I know, I'm sorry. It would have been a tough message for them to hear, and it had been tough for them to believe. Interesting fact, though, Nineveh's name, it comes from an Akkadian word, Nina, which when written in cuneiform, which was the early system of writing of the Sumerians, this is the symbol that meant Nineveh. It was a fish inside of a house. And the Ninevites actually worshipped a fish goddess. So no doubt, I mean, here you got Jonah who shows up, he's just been spit out of a fish, and here he is preaching. It would have been very obvious to look at him that something was wrong with him. After 3 days in the stomach of a great fish with acid in there, it would have bleached his skin, his hair would have been gone, he would have smelled bad, and no doubt people would have heard about it. In fact, Matthew chapter 12 says that Jonah was a sign to the Ninevites. So, word had to be out. No matter where Jonah was spit up, somebody had to see it, and the story was out there. I mean, it was probably on the evening news or the Nineveh Times or whatever the local paper was that they got the news out in the city. People knew what had happened to this guy. There was no doubt. And this is just another example of God being able to take our mess and use it for His glory. God took this man, I mean, who was had run from him and was able to use him to get the attention of these people. Look at verse 5. So the people of Nineveh believed God, proclaimed a fast, and put on sackcloth from the greatest to the least of them. I mean, these are the mighty, powerful warrior people. And they believed the message of Jonah. It'd be like a crazy homeless guy in the middle of Kansas City holding up a sign saying, you know, the end of the world is coming. And people believing him and a revival breaking out. It's really kind of amazing to think about. But God used this message of Jonah to get these people's attention. Verse 6. Then word came to the king of Nineveh. And he arose from his throne and laid aside his robe, covered himself with sackcloth, and sat in the ashes. So word of this message and word of this man makes it all the way up to the king. But not only does the king hear, but he believes and he repents. This wasn't just some kind of a fire insurance conversion where he gets saved so he doesn't go to hell. This king puts on sackcloth and sits in ashes. Now that's an interesting thing that's not done today. Sackcloth and ashes were used in the Old Testament times as a symbol of debasement or mourning or repentance. So here we've got this king of a city who is a horrible person with all the things that have happened, putting on this sackcloth and ashes. This was a symbol. This was someone wanting to show that they had a repentant heart. They would wear the sackcloth and sit in ashes and sometimes even put ashes on the top of their head. Sackcloth was not something that was comfortable to wear. It's not like your favorite pair of blue jeans and your favorite t-shirt. Sackcloth was something that was uncomfortable. It was a coarse material. Usually it was made out of black goat's hair, similar to what we would have today as like a burlap sack. Now, can you imagine wearing your clothes made out of burlap? Do you think that's comfortable? Well, it's not very trendy either. People aren't going to be looking at you thinking, wow, they got it all together. But it was very uncomfortable for the person who was wearing it. And the ashes signified desolation and ruin. This was a man who knew what he had been doing was wrong, repenting and turning to God, showing by this outward sign what was happening on the inside of him. In other words, this wasn't something the king was just going to do for fun. It shows how serious he was about his repentance. Look at verse 7. And he caused it to be proclaimed, the king, and published throughout Nineveh by the decree of the king and his nobles, saying, let neither man nor beast, herd nor flock taste anything. Do not let them eat or drink water. He's so serious about this thing that he puts the word out that nobody, not one person in the kingdom, not even an animal in the kingdom, was supposed to have anything to eat or anything to drink. That's pretty serious. You know it's serious when people start giving up food. Right? Because I don't know what you're like, but I kind of like to eat. I really like to eat. So for someone to give up something that there's nothing wrong with eating, God gave us food to eat, to sustain us, for fuel for our body. So for us to give up something that is not wrong, but rightfully ours, it's okay to have, to show God how serious they are, is a big deal. So the king does that. Look at verse 8. But let man and beast be covered with sackcloth and cry mightily to God. Yes, let everyone turn from his evil way and from the violence that is in his hands. Not only does the king proclaim a nationwide fast, but now he's telling everyone else to put on sackcloth, including the animals. He commands everyone then to turn from their evil ways and from the violence that is in their hands. Now, remember who we're talking about. These are the Assyrians. These are the people who would wipe out entire cities, do horrible things to the people who lived there. These were, killing and raping were national pastimes for these people. They were brutal, bloody people. And the king says, I want you to turn from your evil ways, and I want you to stop the violence. This is a big deal. Verse 9. Who can tell if God will turn and relent and turn away from his fierce anger so that we may not perish? The king says, hopefully, you know, God will show us some mercy if we don't reap what we've sown for so many years. Verse 10. Then God saw their works, that they turned from their evil way, and God relented from his disaster that he had said he would bring upon them, and he did not do it. So it happens. God sees them repent, and God shows mercy. Isn't it awesome that we serve a God who shows mercy? Listen, mercy is something we don't deserve. But God looked down and saw them and was moved and showed mercy. Has God ever shown mercy in your life? If you're breathing God's air right now, he has shown you mercy. You know what I mean? None of us deserve what God has blessed us with in our lives. We live in the greatest nation in the world, I believe. And God has blessed us beyond so many other places. And just by luck of the draw, so to speak, I was able to be born in this country into a family that loved me and cared about me, never had to worry about where my next meal was coming from. And that's pretty obvious by looking at me. Never had to worry about not having clothes to wear. Didn't have to worry about a place where I could lay my head and sleep at night and be safe. But if you look at what happens in so many places around our world, there are countries where children and people go to bed hungry every night. That's normal. My dad went on a missions trip to the Philippines it's been a few years ago. And they went up into this area called the Smoky Mountain. And when we think about the Smoky Mountains here in the States, we think about, you know, Gatlinburg and Tennessee and North Carolina and all the beautiful mountain ranges. But the Smoky Mountains in the Philippines, anybody ever heard of those? It's the dump. And it smokes every day because of the stuff underneath there rotting. So this dump is where people live. They would build their house out of the things that were there. And there was a mission that had been built on top of this huge dump where all the cities, all the people from Manila and all of these areas put their trash. And they would feed people there, this mission would. And they would feed them once a day a little bowl of rice that was flavored with chicken feet and the tips of chicken wing. And if you got a scoop that had a chicken foot or a tip of a chicken wing, you were it. I mean, that was a big deal, but that's all they would get every day. There are people in this world who don't have what we have and haven't been blessed as we've been blessed. And we need to take a look at our own lives and think, many times God has shown me so much mercy and so much grace and so much love and blessed me. We don't deserve it. And Jonah here, to these people giving this message, this chance for repentance before God judged the city, was mercy for God to stop the judgment that was going to come on this city. So as we've looked at this chapter and we've read through it, there's a couple of things I want us to see this morning in our story. Look at verse number 1. Now the word of the Lord came to Jonah the second time, saying. The first thing that really jumped out at me when I read this story again is this. God didn't just give up on Jonah because he ran the first time. God didn't just give up on Jonah because he ran the first time. I'll ask you again, I know I asked you this just a moment ago, but have you ever run from God? Now, I'm not necessarily saying physically like Jonah did, where you jump in the car and take off because God told you to do something. But has there ever been a thought in your mind when God has impressed on you to do something and you thought, I can't do that, or I won't do that? God, I know that that's probably not that, or you may start to justify, well, that can't be God. God would never want me to step out and share my faith, or God would never want me to give that, or God would never want me to, that can't be God. You know, that's just my emotions. And we can blame it on those things, but God will impress us at times to do things. So has there ever been those thoughts that come into your mind, or I can't do that, or I won't do that? God, no, I'm done, I'm out, I'm not messing with that. Sometimes we as Christians use some language that a lot of people outside of Christianity don't understand, so let me drop a little Christianese on you. You ready? Have you ever backslided? Am I the only one? Okay, just making sure. That's what Jonah had done. And just because he did that, God didn't turn his back on him. I mean, it's an awesome thought to think that God was there waiting for him, and that God is there waiting for us to simply look to him, to simply turn to him again. And that's what Jonah did. He turned to God. He began to pray. And we talked about that last week. Just like the prodigal son, when he came back, the father was there watching and waiting. And he didn't make that son come up and beg for his forgiveness and didn't make him feel bad and put him down and talk bad to him. That father ran to meet him and hugged his neck and kissed him and put a ring on his hand, signifying that he was a son again, and the best robe, and killed the fatted calf so that they could have a celebration, because he said, "This my son was dead, but now is alive. He was lost, but is now found." So when he came back to God, when the prodigal came back to the father, there was a celebration. And that whole story is a symbol of us as Christians, when we get away from God, that when we will turn back to him, he is there waiting with open arms, running to meet us and celebrating, "Hey, this was my son who was gone. He had taken off from me, but he's coming home now, and we're going to party." And that's a big deal. That's a big deal. That's the father. He was there waiting. And he came back for Jonah. You know, I think this is awesome. I wrote this down in my Bible several times while I was reading this. And that's this: running from God doesn't disqualify me from serving him in the future. Running from God doesn't disqualify me from serving him in the future. Because there have been times when I've run from God, and I thank God that he didn't disqualify me from serving him. Serving is central to Christianity. Jesus is the ultimate picture of the servant. And that's one of the tenets, the core values of the Christian faith, is that we are saved to serve. If we're not serving, then we are not following after Christ. So let me ask you this question: are you serving? Where are you serving? Well, I'm an usher, or I'm a greeter. Or, man, that's awesome. I help with this ministry or that ministry. Praise God. But there's many that aren't. And we need your help. If we're going to reach this community, and God has strategically put our church in a place and in a time to do something great for him. I mean, there is, as the Bible says, and as the sign on the name on the sign says, an open door for us. Are you with me? Look at where our church is located. The growth of the city is headed this direction. There are people who are working a mile from here every day, thousands of people. People drive by this exit every day, going to and coming from work. God has put us in a place where new subdivisions are being built, and houses and plots, and all kinds of people are moving to this area. Are we reaching them? Well, that's the pastor and deacon's job. Oh, where's that in the Bible? Hello. I hope you wore steel toe boots today. It's every one of our jobs. We're all saved to serve. And God's called every one of us to be a servant. And we've got some big plans here to be able to reach out into our community. We're going to be starting some new ministries that we need help with. We want to be able to, when a guest pulls into the parking lot, to have somebody out there waving and greeting them and showing them where to go, and people who can walk them into the building and show them where their kids need to go for a class or whatnot, and help them find where the bathrooms are. I mean, how many times you walk into a place and what's the first thing you look for? If you're like me, I'm always looking for a bathroom. So we need help. We've got to show people. And it's, you know, God is looking for a place where he can send people to. Because the Bible says it's not God's will that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. God wants every person to meet him. God wants every person to come to his son, Jesus. So we've got to do our best to help them and arrange this meeting. So that means every one of us have a place. We're all a part of the body of Christ, and we've all been gifted in different ways. My gifts, passions, and abilities are different than your gifts, passions, and ability. And the mix of gifts that God has given to you fits perfectly with what God has called you to do with your life, just as the gifts, talents, and abilities God has given me fit perfectly for what he has called me to do with my life. Now, as the Bible says, if you look in Ephesians, it talks about the all of the parts work together and we are a part of the body of Christ. And no part of the body is more important than another part. Every part is necessary for the growth of the body. So we've all got to do our part and to serve. We're going to be asking in the future, I know this might scare some of you, but we're going to be asking some of you to serve in different areas. Now, we're not asking you to come in and work hours and hours every week, but, you know, if you could volunteer for 1 hour every month, that doesn't seem like a whole lot, does it? 1 hour a month? Am I the only one that thinks that's not a long time? That's like, that's an hour, I mean. I used to think an hour was a long time. You know, as a kid, when you're driving in the car on vacation, how far are we? An hour. Now I'm thinking like an hour? I got 10 million things to do. An hour just doesn't cover it. So as life changes, perspective changes, but we're going to be asking some of you to help with different areas like that, whether it's in the parking lot or helping us with keeping the building clean or things like that. We're going to be reaching out and asking, hey, could you serve? Not us. Could you serve, not even this church, but could you serve Christ? Could you volunteer just a little bit to help us get the word out? Could you help us reach into the lives of people and make a difference? Because, hey, when somebody comes in here, and we had two adults saved a couple of weeks ago, we had one saved last week, you know, every single person who volunteers on here has a part of that. It's not just me who stands up here and shares the word, but if nobody turned the lights on, nobody could see me. That might be a blessing. If there wasn't somebody back there in that little booth back there, you wouldn't be able to hear me. And that might be an even bigger blessing. But it takes all of us. And we'll all be rewarded when we get to heaven for what we do and how we serve. So as we go forward, we need your help. That's all free. That's extra in the message this morning, but we're saved to serve. We want to be obedient followers of Jesus. It's a central theme in the New Testament, a central teaching of Jesus. Look at verse 2. Arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and preach to it the message that I tell you. So Jonah arose in verse 3 and went to Nineveh according to the word of the Lord. Now Nineveh was an exceedingly great city, a 3 days' journey in extent. And Jonah began to enter the city the first day's walk. Then he cried out and said, yet 40 days and Nineveh shall be overthrown. So the people of Nineveh believed God, proclaimed a fast, and put on sackcloth from the greatest to the least of them. And the word came to the king of Nineveh, and he arose from the throne and laid aside his robe, covered himself with sackcloth, and sat in ashes. So not only in our story here, this chapter 3, do we see that God didn't give up on Jonah, and God doesn't give up on us just because we run from him the first time. We also see that God used Jonah in a great way even after his great sin. God used Jonah in a great way even after his great sin. God can and God desires to use imperfect people even after we've sinned against him. Is there anybody who is perfect in this room? Would you just raise your hand? I don't see anybody. My hand's definitely not up. We're not perfect because all of us have strayed away from God at some point in our life. And that's an awesome thought to think that God still wants to use us. Again, running from God doesn't disqualify us from serving him in the future. Now, that doesn't mean we can serve him while we're running, but as soon as we look back to him, he's there. Think about all the great men in God's word and women in God's word who ran from God and were still used by God. Noah, who built the great ark and was saved through the flood, was a drunk. Jacob, one of the fathers of Israel, was a liar. Moses, who led God's people into the promised land out of bondage in Egypt, Moses was a murderer. Samson, who was one of the greatest judges in Israel's history, had a problem with morality and chased prostitutes. David, who was the man after God's own heart, the king of Israel, the sweet psalmist of Israel, was a murderer and an adulterer. Solomon, who was the wisest man who ever lived, when God asked him what he would want, and he said, give me wisdom to rule your people, had a problem with women as well. He had over 750 wives. I mean, I can't keep up with one. The great prophet Elijah was suicidal. Peter, one of the disciples who walked with Jesus for 3.5 years, denied that he was a follower of Jesus. And we could go on and on and on and on with people in God's Word who were not perfect, who were sinners that God used in a great way. And just like God didn't give up on Jonah, God is not giving up on us. So, God didn't give up on Jonah because he ran. God used Jonah in a great way even after his great sin. Now I want us to see the results of Jonah's obedience. What were the results when he finally obeyed what God told him to do? The results are amazing. Jonah finally obeys. The whole country repents, including the king. God spares an entire city of people. The result was the mercy of God was shown in a big way. I mean, these horrible people who've done unspeakable things, who did not deserve mercy. They deserved justice. They deserved judgment. They deserved death. And by the way, so do we, because God's word says that the penalty for sin is what? And didn't we all just admit that we've all sinned because none of us are perfect? So then according to God's word, every single one of us deserve death. And that word death means a separation from God in a place called hell. Because we have all sinned. Every single one of us. But God is a God of mercy. In Ephesians 2, he says, God saved you by his grace when you believed. And you can't take credit for this. It's a gift of God. Salvation is not a reward for the good things we have done, so none of us can boast about it. That's powerful right there. Salvation is a gift from God, a gift that we do not deserve. Titus chapter 3 says, he saved us not because of the righteous things we've done, but because of his mercy. He washed away our sins, giving us new birth and new life through the Holy Spirit. He generously poured out the Spirit on us through Jesus Christ our Savior. Because of his grace, he declared us righteous, or in a right standing with God, and gave us confidence that we will inherit eternal life. Salvation came to this city because a reluctant Christian finally obeyed God. Who could God show mercy to if you and I would just obey him? Who could God show salvation to if you and I would just simply obey him? God did something big when Jonah finally surrendered to God's will. The great British revivalist Henry Varley was talking to another great preacher, D.L. Moody, and he said this: the world has yet to see what God can do with a man fully surrendered to him. Later on, when D.L. Moody recalled this, he said this: with God's help, I will be that man. God saved an entire city and transformed them all because of one reluctant prophet. If God could change people like the Ninevites because of one backslidden Christian, what, can I ask you, could God do in Kansas City with a church full of Christians who are willing to obey him? With God's help, I'd like to say with D.L. Moody, I want us to be that church. I want us to be that people. What makes the difference? Obedience. Obeying God. So are we running from God? Are you running from him this morning? Can I tell you, he hasn't given up on you? He still has a plan for your life. And it's something that only you can do. And it is a great plan. The results of a surrendered life are immeasurable. So will you be that man or will you be that woman this morning? Would you bow your heads with me? Father, I love you. I thank you for this church. And I thank you for the great people that you brought into it. Lord, we have some great servants. We have some people who are just unbelievable that you've brought together. This is, and you've brought every single one of us here. I thank you for that, Lord. You've put us in a place and in a time to do a job for you that only we can do. So help us, Father, to follow you and to be faithful to you. Even if we've run from it in the past, Lord, help us to follow your will for our lives, to turn like Jonah did, Jonah wasn't the most eloquent guy. Just a little short, in his language, would have been a 5-word message. But it's not about the message. It's about the person who the message is about. And that's you. And you can make a difference no matter what Jonah would have been saying. You even used a donkey in the Old Testament to turn people to you. And if you could use a donkey, you could sure use me. Help us to be that people. Help us to be that church. If you're here this morning and you're not a Christian, you've never come into that relationship with Jesus, but you, through listening this morning, you understand that you're a sinner, because we said we're all imperfect people. And you heard the verse that says we all deserve death because of our sins. That's the penalty. But the good news is that Jesus Christ paid that penalty for us. The Bible says God showed his love to us by dying on the cross for our sins. He paid the penalty. He died so that I wouldn't have to. The Bible says in Romans that anyone who calls on him will be saved. That's where I turn to him, understanding I'm a sinner, understanding I deserve to go to hell because of my sins, knowing what Jesus did and believing that he died on a cross to pay the penalty for my sins, and freely, personally accepting that free gift. And if you've never done that this morning, you can do that today. You can know for sure that heaven will be your home someday when you pass. It's as just as sure as you woke up this morning and drew your breath just a moment ago. You can depend on what God has said. He's given us his word. And you can do it this morning. You can do it right where you're seated. You don't have to make a big show. You don't have to even speak out loud, because God hears the prayer of our hearts. So as you're seated there this morning with me, if you've never trusted Christ as your Savior, never done it before, but you'd like to have a relationship with him, would you just pray right where you're seated in your own heart? I'll even help you with what to say, but it's not the words that save you, it's your heart and turning to God. And if you mean it, he's promised he would accept you. So would you just pray with me if you want to accept that free gift of salvation? Again, not out loud, but quietly in your own heart, just pray with me. Dear God, I know I'm a sinner, and I know I deserve to go to hell because of my sins. But thank you for dying on the cross and paying the penalty for my sins. And the best I know how, I accept your free gift of salvation. Thank you. In Jesus' name.